the term red tide, or more commonly pink tide, to avoid confusion with the oceanic phenomenon, is a term applied to the rise of socialist, usually anti-American regimes in Central and South America starting in the late 1990s, spearheaded by Hugo Chavez in Venezuela. But by the early 2010s, classicalist governments, both conservative and liberal, took power across the region, all while Venezuela's nominally elective socialist system collapsed amid total chaos and a dictatorship became the only way to maintain Chavism, seemingly marking the end of the Pink Tide's legitimacy in the region. Indeed, it ushered in a decade of a return to both left and right-wing variants of classicalist counter-revolutionary politics, sometimes referred to as the White or Blue Tide. However, now, a decade later, politics in many nations of the world, including in this region, have changed to become dramatically more extreme and full of mass hysteria, causing polarization on both sides of the political spectrum that in Central and South America hallmarked a new pink tide. This also comes amidst the current context of renewed great power competition and ideological conflict in the world. One recent instance that may or may not be considered part of the pink tide is something that happened the day before the updated map was released on December 1st, that being the transformation of the Commonwealth Realm of Barbados to a republic. Oftentimes, the pink tide or white tide labels are only applied to Spanish-speaking or Portuguese-speaking countries. Plus, there was not a revolutionary or constitutional-changing element to this. Instead, the classicalist constitution was retained, but with the place of the current British monarch and their local governor-general replaced by a presidency. However, the country's de facto ruler will remain Mia Motley, the elected prime minister, who along with her cabinet embarked on the plan to abolish the monarchy. Despite the Prime Minister's left-leaning positions and anti-monarchist stance, both the country's continuing classicalist constitution, along with its place outside the Iberian-speaking Americas, make it questionable as to whether this is part of the Pink Tide proper, but it does illustrate the geopolitical context of the region and the ideological conflict within it. With Britain publicly congratulatory, yet nervous for the long term about the potential opening provided to Beijing and Havana, despite the new republic's continuation of the classicalist constitution and democracy. So after Prime Minister Motley announced the plan in September of 2020, on November 30th, 2021, the Commonwealth Realm of Barbados was officially transformed into the State of Barbados. The new pink tide proper has been exemplified most recently and most dramatically by Chile, so we'll go into the full context and details of that. However, other Iberian-speaking countries of the Americas have seen similar and sometimes as dramatic phenomena as well. Bolivia was a part of the 2000s pink tide, with leftist President Evo Morales having changed the Bolivian constitution in 2009, creating the present-day plurinational state. Morales continued running for president through the 2019 elections, which ended in controversy. Morales was ousted by what he called a right-wing conspiracy, and he briefly fled to exile. However, Morales would return to Bolivia upon the election of ally Lucho Arce as president in 2020, a fellow member of Morales' left-wing coalition and a supporter of the country's current plurinational constitution promulgated under Morales, thus firmly placing Bolivia in the middle of the new pink tide. Certainly, Cuba and Venezuela remain at the head of that camp, with both regimes offering extensive political support to regional allies and thus becoming part of Caracas and Havana's socialist spheres of influence. In the 2021 Peruvian elections, it appeared this influence and the pink tide would be in full force in the country, as the winner was Pedro Castillo, who ran on the ticket of the openly Marxist Free Peru Party. However, after taking office, Castillo toned down any revolutionary rhetoric, while also committing to retain the current classicalist constitution and making agreements with foreign businesses to enact liberal, yet classicalist and non-revolutionary policies. Castillo also reportedly holds more conservative social views, though his government ministers hold further left, although again non-red, positions, and support the current constitution. Yet despite Peru not being in the pink tide at the moment, largely owing to the man in power, the elections themselves reflect extreme polarization and ideological conflict in the country that is emblematic of the new pink tide. A similar example is seen in El Salvador. Although previously a member of a far-left party, including several mayoral victories under the banner, Nayib Bukele was expelled for disagreements within the party and later set up his own classicalist party based on economic capitalism and Salvadorian nationalism. He then won the 2019 presidential elections, and his policies have won popular support since. though he's also engaged in some censorship techniques, as well as aggressively pursuing policies of power consolidation. This, along with the fact that it means El Salvador has solidified its position within the blue or white camp, have drawn some strong disapproval, but for now it's a small minority. Thus, for now, it seems El Salvador is firmly within the anti-red camp in the region, and an opponent of the pink tide. That being said, the geopolitics is not so black and white, as despite Bukele's good relationship with the Trump administration, the Joe Biden administration has been more apt to criticize some of his more heavy-handed policies, thus adding yet another angle to the geopolitics, with American administrations always liable to change. Honduras had been an ancillary part of the early 2000s era Pink Tide, with Manuel Zelaya leading a center-left coalition, but eventually attempting a constitutional change in 2009, with a variety of reasons, most of them personal motivations, ascribed, although it does not appear that installing a socialist constitution was one of them. Thus, the country was on the periphery of the Pink Tide. However, it was fully involved in the White Tide when a referendum about that proposed constitutional change led to a coup against Zelaya. Now, a decade later, Zelaya's wife, Xiomara, has been elected president. However, she won on the ticket of the revolutionary socialist movement, Liberty and Refoundation. It's unclear whether Xiomara will, like her husband, attempt constitutional change, but even while the classicalist constitution remains in place, the decidedly anti-classicalist and anti-capitalist ruling coalition places Honduras somewhere on the scale of this new pink tide. Back on the subject of Chile, this was a country that was not involved in the 1990s and early 2000s pink tide. However, the pink tide of the 90s and early 2000s was not the first time this phenomenon occurred, and this has largely been a recurring region of geopolitical and ideological conflict every couple of decades over the past 50 plus years. We've examined one of these waves of ideological conflict in Argentina in the 1970s in our biography of Leopoldo Galtieri. At the same time, Cold War conflict was also playing out in neighboring Chile. The conflict was mainly between the large number of tenant farmers, the inquilinos, and the largest state owners, the latifundia. Another source for this conflict was the presence of foreign companies within the Chilean economy. A parliamentary conservative won the first election in which many of the inquilinos could vote. However, by the time of the next election in 1970, a left-wing coalition had risen to prominence led by Salvador Allende, whose platform was called the Chilean Way to Socialism. As he'd been democratically elected, it was unclear whether Allende would engage in large-scale Marxist policy, such as the nationalization of estates, nationalization of foreign companies, and a potential new constitution. However, while holding off on the constitution, he quickly began enacting land reform and nationalized Chile's enormous copper industry, with the country to this day supplying a third of the world's copper supplies. Other foreign companies, particularly American, were nationalized. These policies certainly rang alarm bells both within the Chilean establishment in military and in Washington. However, the tension was ratcheted up even further in the fall of 1971 when Cuban communist leader Fidel Castro made a state visit to Chile. He only intended on staying for a week. However, he became so popular and got along so well with Allende that he ended up staying for a month.
In Cuba, Fidel Castro
tuvo que luchar con las armas en la mano.
Had to fight arms in hand.
Porque no había otra salida.
Because there was no other way to do it.
En Chile hemos usado el camino legal.
And in Chile we have followed the legal channels.
While elements within the Chilean establishment did the little they could to resist or undermine Allende's policies, their efforts were bolstered by the Nixon administration, which sought to economically isolate Chile while maintaining diplomatic contact with anti-communist forces within the country.
Now we have one country in the Western Hemisphere, Cuba, that is exporting revolution, and we didn't want another one, Chile, doing. Allende played it very cleverly. But on the other hand, there wasn't any question about his turning all the screws that he possibly could in the direction of making Chile a Marxist state. An Italian businessman came to call on me in the Oval Office, and he said, if Allende should win the election in Chile, and then you have Castro in Cuba, what you will in effect have in Latin America is a red sandwich. And eventually, it'll all be red. Chile, of course, is interested in obtaining loans from international organizations where we have a vote. And I indicated that wherever we had a vote, where Chile was involved, that unless there were strong considerations on the other side, that we would vote against.
On June 29, 1973, low-ranking military officers attempted a coup against Allende. While the coup was put down by the military leadership, the country was seemingly on the brink of civil war. Both forces on the left and right were growing less supportive of the Allende government, to some extent due to the successful internal and external undermining. But in any case, Allende's position was severely under threat from seemingly all sides. On the 11th of September, a more wide-scale coup was launched, led by Vice Admiral Jose Toribio Marino, who deposed the head of the Navy and drafted a document placing political power in the hands of a military council, or junta, and joined in signing by the existing Air Force Chief Gustavo Lee, along with General Cesar Mendoza, who deposed the head of the Carabineros Gendarme. Because Army Chief Augusto Pinochet had been appointed by Allende and had played a central role in the foiling of the earlier coup attempt, along with the previous Commander-in-Chief Carlos Prats, the coup makers were not sure whether Pinochet would join in the plot, but as with Lee, they decided to give him a chance. Pinochet took aggressively to this role, and as Allende barricaded himself in the presidential palace, which was put under siege, eventually leading to Allende's death by his hand or another, Pinochet declared the new junta to be the only political authority in the country and named himself the council's chairman, the de facto president, and 2 years later he would name himself the official president. This was decidedly the end of the 1960s and 70s red wave or pink tide across Chile. General Pinochet would rule the country by decree for 17 years. He set up a secret police, the DINA, to go after communists, suspected leftists, and regime opponents, which detained or executed thousands. However, this policy later ran afoul of Pinochet's backers abroad when the DINA launched Operation Condor, a program to go after political opponents in other countries. This led to the bombing of Orlando Letelier, Allende's former defense minister, on the streets of Washington, D.C. in 1981. Although the Reagan administration was sympathetic and supported Pinochet's classicalist dictatorship, many of the hardline conservatives of the Nixon years were replaced by neoconservatives who wanted the democratization of America-aligned classicalist dictatorships such as Pinochet's once an open market economy had been established. Though they forced Pinochet to back down on the DINA and Operation Condor, they did heavily support Pinochet's economic initiatives, as did the Chilean business establishment whose position had been under threat in the first place. Following these free market neoliberal principles, which were being preached by Pinochet's American advisors, the Chicago Boys, the general did not simply restore the pre-Allende economy the way it had been, but instead wanted to put Chile in a position where it would never be in the situation it fell into in the 1960s and 70s again. While some of the confiscated estates were given back to their landowners, who were eligible to repurchase 30% of their previous land, the remainder was sold in small plots, though much of it was eventually purchased back by its original owners. Nonetheless, the most painful part of the economic transition was certainly the industrial sector, where the reprivatized companies needed to lay off many of their workers whose salaries had been subsidized by taxpayer funds. Eventually, a large and robust private sector economy would spring up, leading to the policies to be labeled the Chilean economic miracle. Although they clearly didn't work for every segment of society, and the country did continue to be frustrated by Pinochet's ongoing dictatorship, satisfaction with the country's economic conditions grew through the 1980s. This followed what was perhaps the most important event in linking this to today, the 1980 Chilean Constitution. This constitution locked in place the economic reforms and laid out a path back to elected democracy while also making sure the country would remain in a classicalist heading, and again locked in capitalist, specifically free market capitalist, economics. Pinochet's own constitution led to his ouster by plebiscite in 1989, though he would continue to serve in several high government roles for the remainder of his life, including head of the army and senator, playing a kind of head of state emeritus role. However, the last 4 years of his life, he was stripped of some of his titles and court cases were launched, although they never went anywhere, and he died in December of 2006. The legacy Pinochet left was extremely polarizing, with many viewing him as a villain due to the extrajudicial killings under his leadership, along with his reversal of some of the economic reforms and his favoritism towards the business establishment. Yet others viewing him as a hero for getting rid of communism and for creating the Chilean economic model, which went on to be copied by other up-and-coming markets. After nearly 40 years under the pro-business constitution, during which the country was the wealthiest by per capita GDP in South America, protests aimed at stemming inequality erupted in 2019. Although they took a brief break for the beginning of the coronavirus pandemic, they were back in the summer of 2020 and took on a revolutionary character, demanding a new constitution. One of the leaders of this campaign was Gabriel Boric, a 34-year-old leftist MP. They successfully negotiated for a plebiscite on a new constitution, which was supposed to take place in the spring of 2020, but later was postponed to the fall, at which point it followed more protests over the summer. This plebiscite would pass, and a constitutional convention has been converged in the country. In the context of this victory, Boric ran for president on the ticket of the leftist coalition Approved Dignity, a coalition that includes members of the Communist Party of Chile. Boric was running against a hardline classicalist conservative, José Antonio Kast, who also was a strong backer of the free market principles specifically embedded within the previous classicalist constitution. His father had served with the German armed forces during World War II, and like many Germans, Austrians, and Italians, had fled to South America to avoid possible retribution by the Soviet Union. Whether any of this background contributed negatively to Kast's campaign remains a matter of debate, but the fact remains he lost the December 19, 2021 election by a count of nearly 11 points. Thus, as the Boric-backed new constitution is being promulgated, the man himself will take office on March 11, 2022. The throwing out of the Chilean economic model, long thought to be one of the strongest in the region, and the potential promulgation of a leftist constitution combined with the election of a leftist president has taken the country in a very new direction, and extreme uncertainty for the future grips Chile for the first time since the previous polarization of the 1960s and 70s. Chile's previous place as a leader within the region and the context of the rising pink tide elsewhere in the region has once again started ringing alarm bells for both classicalists and Chile and think tank analysts in Washington. Though the Biden administration has taken a mostly hands-off approach and maintained cordial relations so far. But as we've seen in previous examples, this is always subject to change whenever new administrations come to power in Washington, especially a possibility given Boric's outspoken anti-American and anti-Israel sentiment. That being said, what happens in Chile from here remains to be seen, but it does seem that the former bastion of classicalist politics and capitalist economics within Central and South America may now be the bastion of the new pink tide. In any case, we'll keep an eye on the situation, especially within the context of great power competition and regional power competition. Thank you so much for watching. Make sure to check out the project that forms the basis for these videos at apoliticalworldmap.org. Make sure to like and subscribe, comment, share the video with others, and if you can, donate on Patreon. Thanks so much again for watching. I'm Alex. I am out.